Yes, yes. What's up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Houseless Podcast. My name is Peter Augusta. I'm the host and producer of the show. Thank you for tuning in. We have a great episode for you with a very special guest. This is episode 49 of it. And I don't usually start the show with saying what episode number it is. Like, it's all kind of arbitrary to me. But we're nearing, you know, a monument, a landmark, a mile marker on the show, and that it's getting close to the 1 year anniversary, because I think I did the very first one in early September with Matt Deal, and here we are, we're getting there, number 49. And if you're listening during the month of August, each week of this month I'm posting, releasing, dropping 2 episodes a week. So it's a lot of work. Every episode is edited and engineered by CJ Stewart. He's in California, I'm in New York, I'm in Brooklyn, he's in Humboldt, and we don't see each other that often, but we talk all the time, and somehow we manage to make these podcasts work. And I gotta thank you guys, you're the whole reason why this happens. So if you subscribe, if you just listen and occasionally check in, thank you. If you're listening to this one right now, because of my guest, I gotta give you some love. Thank you so much. You can find us on iTunes, it's on the Stitcher app, Google Play, it's on YouTube as well, and it's definitely on SoundCloud. So if you're on SoundCloud, big up to you guys. You help a tremendous amount because you repost it. So I urge you, if you're into SoundCloud, take the link, and if you have a page yourself, just hit that repost button, and it goes a long way. Or find us on Twitter at HouselessPod, and you can repost it that way. Just got to pay some dues before we get into this great, great conversation with my guest, Sam Spiegel, recorded here in New York City. Sam, a.k.a. Squeaky Clean, yes, who none other than Guru, Ballhead Slick, in the intro, rest in peace, Gangstar for Life, the Gangstar Foundation. That was an early track produced by our guest, Sam. And I think one of his first pieces of physical music, it was a 12-inch. It came out on Dim Mac in like 2003-04. 2Mex on the flip side. And I had to ask him about it. And not to put him on blast with that track, but I had to have that little clip just for context. Because we'll end the show with Sam's most recent single, called Mutant Brain, and that's under the Sam Spiegel name, with incredible dancehall track with Assassin. You can find it on Spotify, it's on iTunes. There was amazing music video short that Sam collaborated with Kenzo and his brother, the filmmaker Spike Jones. And right after we had recorded this conversation in his apartment in New York City, they had just celebrated an award that was given for this film, the visual component to Mutant Brain. So check it out. It was kind of a collaboration with a company called Kenzo. So if you haven't seen it, I definitely recommend it. It's a pretty brilliant piece of work. And for a short music visual type of thing, it's more of a music visual, not necessarily a video. Definitely peep it out. And because that's also the most recent single on Interscope Records. And there's another one coming up, so look out for it. It's called To Whom It May Concern with CeeLo and Theophilus London, Alex Ebert, all on one track. And, you know, I will say this, and we talked about this in the conversation. I think one of Sam's greatest qualities as a producer and a songwriter and composer, if you will, is that he can bring a lot of different people onto a song together, musicians, vocalists, you know, MCs, singers, and all that. I mean, him and Karen O did an incredible project together. In fact, Sam and I even collaborated back in the day when I was managing Sadat X. This isn't too long ago, it's about a decade ago, maybe a little more. And the two of them did a record together, and we talk about this in the conversation, so I'm not going to go long on it. And it was during Sam's era of his NASA project, which I'm sure many of you will remember. They did 2 great albums. the spirit of the Apollo, spirit of Apollo, rather, and the Big Bang. And yes, Dot and Sam did this joint, and it was going to be something with some other cats, and it just was one of those things that didn't ended up materializing. But the guy is great at pulling references from different places and people from different spots and getting them together. I mean, those NASA records are a great testament to that. Because there were some like major, you know, artists on that, on those joints. Kanye, Tom Waits, Old Dirty, and so on and so forth. And yeah, so we, you know, vibe on that a little bit. We talk about, you know, something that I learned is that we were born a day apart, 79. October 30th is my birthday. His is Halloween. So yeah, it was pretty cool. And, you know, Sam and I have a great mutual friend, the filmmaker, director. One of my most favorite music video directors, Wendy Morgan, who put us in touch a long time ago. And I remember going to LA many, many years ago and, peeping him out in his studio, one of his older studios. And so It's a good chat where, because I want to know, you know, about the whole story. And obviously, you know, his brother Spike has done some amazing work, both especially like in the initial, like that skate world, and then with Grand Royal Magazine and Dirt Magazine. And of course, his film work is incredible. Absolutely. So we kind of, you know, there's this kind of dynamic between brothers, and I have an older brother, and I found that they can really be such a great influence too, even if it's just, you know, in your universe in a way. So yeah, there's that. And yeah, I'm just happy to finally be able to share this with you, because we did a little bit ago. Then I went to the West Coast, recorded a bunch of episodes. So I was waiting for the perfect time, and I felt like 49 is the perfect time for this episode of The House List. Peter Gossin, Sam Spiegel, in the place. Let's get into this joint. And don't think I didn't ask him. Wait, you just can figure it out by the end. I asked him a question I've been wondering a long time about, a very, very, very brief cameo he made in a film. So here we go, my conversation with Sam Spiegel here on The House List. Enjoy, and I'll see you guys on the outro. Because you have a studio in L.A., which I'm not sure if you still have that one that was sort of like by Amoeba, you know?
Back alley, no.
Yeah.
No,
so that was like the first real L.A. studio for you, yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, well, it was my first. I had a studio before that. I had a couple studios before that, but that was where, like, really stuff started happening, and like that's where I started my company out of that, out
right.
of that house, and you know, did records. The first time I did Yeah's record out of there. And
nice. Is that where the Guru and Tumex record came from, that area?
Yeah.
Nice.
Yes. The Guru Tumex record.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, it's funny looking back, because now you've done like your whole, you know, catalog as a producer, and it's been so wide and prolific too. But I love going back to that particular record, because it's basically the first time you were like on wax, right? If I'm not mistaken, right?
Yep. Yeah, the way it is. Yeah.
And it was even in the moment too, because it was on Dim Mac, and Dim Mac hadn't really been, they were putting out like rock bands and stuff, and like indie rock, LA like indie rock bands at that time. It's like, I don't remember the year. It must have been 2003 or 4.
Yeah, that sounds about
that
right.
Era. But the fact that it was Guru and then Tumex too, which was also pretty unusual at that time too. I feel like that's like a good, in a way, that's one good starting point for your, to, for us to talk a little bit about your career too. Cause I remember when that came out, and it was just such an unusual record in the moment. Like, how did that, it's just a 2-song 12 inch basically, but where, what's the story with that record like for you?
Oh man, I can't remember how I met. I just wanted to put a record out,
right.
And I was making beats for so long, and you know, at the time, I think that was while I was still working on the Fat Lip record, and it hadn't come out yet. I hadn't really put anything out yet, and I hadn't put any stuff like as my artist projects ever before. And I just met Tumex, I forget how, and I was just like, man, I'm gonna just do a 2-song, like a single, you know, like a A and a B, and did that song with Tumex. I can't remember how we met. I think we might have met at this record store that used to be in Studio City.
Aaron's?
Or Van Nuys.
Oh, okay.
on Ventura Boulevard. I can't remember the name of it. I think we just met like when we were vibing it there. And then I just decided I wanted to reach out to Guru and do a song with him. And that was a funny experience too, because he was out for a Gangstar show
in LA.
In LA at right. the House of Blues, and and I was just like a fresh faced kid, like, oh, it's a Guru, man.
Yeah, man.
And so he invited me to the show. Then he had me come pick him up at the hotel afterwards.
Okay.
And he had me waiting for so long in the lobby. Then he comes down with this girl. I guess he brought a girl back from the show.
Mm-hmm. And he was after the show.
And he was bragging because he's like, man, you know, I brought this girl back to the show, went upstairs, fucked, took a shower, put on fresh clothes, let's go. And then I was like, all right, man, great, cool, let's go, let's like to the studio. He's like, oh, wait, I got to go to this after party first. So then I was like, oh, okay, well, it's already like midnight. And he's like, no, it's cool, man, it's cool. So then we go to this after party. And it's the official Gangstar after party.
Nice, okay.
And actually, it was the first time I ever saw AM DJ. AM was DJ.
Nice, there. Yeah, absolutely.
And it was like pre-sober, skinny AM. Right, but it was like, I was still like, whoa, this dude. He was like on his BlackBerry, fucking scratching. Like, it was crazy. I'd never seen anybody DJ like that. And but I just hung out with Guru and had some drinks, and Guru would just he would be in this one spot. It was so funny because it was the Gangstar after party, and he sat in this one spot where everybody walked through, because everyone would like give him props on the way through the party. But like the whole time we were there for like 2 hours, and I was stressing because I knew he left like at like 5 a.m. to the next city whatever. Yeah. And I was like, come on, dude, can we go back to see? And he was in this one spot where everybody walked by, and every girl that walked by, he just would like try and holler at her and like grab her hand and stuff. And that was the whole night. We were just hanging out there. I was drinking, watching AM, and watching Guru like holler at every girl in this party. Classic. It was so funny. Then finally at like 2 a.m., he's like, all right, let's go, let's go. And then he just came over to the studio to Crack Alley and like just smoked blunt after blunt and recorded the shit until like 6 a.m.
Wow.
To go straight to catch a bus.
That's amazing. Yeah, I was wondering, yeah, because this is even of the era when people weren't really mailing tracks back and forth too at that time. This is like, you know, early 2000s too. And it's Gangstar era too, so that must have been the owners or something, their last record, possibly, I would think, right?
Yeah, I guess you're
something
right,
like
yeah.
That, maybe. Yeah, that's amazing. I was wondering what your experience. Did you ever see? Was that the one and only time you saw him too? Was that?
Yep.
Amazing. Yeah. And you have a record with him. I mean, and now it's like looking back, because I listened to that record on the way over here. It still holds up too.
Nice,
you know?
Man. Yeah. Heard it for so long.
You should go back. I mean, yeah, and it's Guru. I mean, that's the thing. It's like the legacy of Gangstar too is, you know, impenetrable. You know, it's timeless. So it's nice to like kind of go back to some of those loose joints he did. Still pre-Solar, you know, that era where he was doing all those other kind of records. So, yeah, that's dope. But you're a native New Yorker, though, yeah? So, like, even though you've been stationed in L.A. for quite a while, like, and produced a lot of your stuff, you were born and raised here, yeah?
Yeah, I grew up here.
I think I realized, too, like, that we were born almost on the same day in the same year. So you were, your Halloween...
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm October 30th, 1979. So,
whoa,
yeah.
Crazy.
Yeah. So I was like looking, I was doing a little bit of research right before I came, just going, all right, let me make sure I talk about what I want to talk about. And I looked at that, I'm like, damn. So yeah, we basically grew up simultaneously at the same time.
Wow. What hospital?
Well, I wasn't born in New York, I was born in Virginia. Oh, okay. So I didn't come to New York until I was like 18, until after high school. And I was here just for... like for half a year, and I worked at a record store, and then I moved out west, and then I came back here in 2005. So yeah, a little different experience, but you know the same years and being, you know, seemingly influenced by a lot of the same stuff, because you kind of sort of your entry point with music was like hip hop, or just in New York, it's you have access to so much more than just hip hop, but What was that like for you? Like,
I mean, I don't know if I'd say my entry point into music was that, because I like listened to tons of music my whole life, even like, you know. But yeah, I grew up in what I consider like the golden age of hip hop in New York City. And it was definitely a huge, huge influence for me, and I just loved like all the Native Tongue shit. All the Native Tongue shit was popping when I was like, you know, a young adolescent, and you know, Tribe Called Quest, and even like, you know, Video Music Box was on.
Ralph McDaniels.
Yeah, that was like, I watched that like as much as possible. I get home to watch that.
And did you call in?
I never called in. No,
you didn't. Okay, no. Cool.
And for those of y'all that don't know, it was a public access show.
Yeah.
That on UHF TV, which doesn't exist anymore, right?
Is UHF? I don't think so. I mean, there is New York public access, but it's definitely changed with technology, you know.
And it was like the hottest new shit, and it was a music video show that played like the hottest, and it wasn't just the like mainstream shit, it was like obscure underground stuff that at the time used to have videos. Like there was actually videos for it was like King Juss or like like whatever. Like it was, I remember seeing like the first Organized Confusion single in there, Stress video, and like it was amazing. It was just an amazing time in music, because you'd be listening to that, or like even Friday Night Flavors at the time, Funk Flex was like amazing. I taped it every week. I never wanted to miss it, because it was like there'd be some new shit that was out that I would miss if I didn't hear it that week.
And Stretch and Bob too. You listen to Stretch and Bob, obviously.
Stretch and Bobbito, yeah, hell yeah.
You have two siblings too. Are both of them older than you?
Yeah, my sister's much older.
Right.
She didn't put me on the hip hop too much, but she put me on a couple cool records. Like, she gave me like these Trouble Funk albums when
really?
I was like,
okay.
super young.
That oh, that's what's
like,
up.
Oh,
yeah.
What is this shit? Like, because they grew up in New York and DC, more in DC. Than
interesting.
New York.
Okay, yeah.
And then, yeah, my brother put me on, he gave me Low End Theory, and he put me on to some great hip hop shit early on, and he was already like fucking with the Beastie Boys too, so I was like, felt extra. I already loved them actually before he put me onto them, I was like, "Whoa, he's like, he knows these guys. That's cool." And then I go out there and like hang with him, and I'd be like, "Dude, I hung out with Mike D. We stayed at Mike D's house."
Yeah, I mean that's incredible. Yeah,
yeah, it was like, fun. It was
so he was already out in L.A. when you were like in high school or kind of coming.
Yeah, he moved to L.A. when I was 8 years old.
Oh, okay,
because he's 10 years old. So he was out there when he was 18.
Yeah, I have a brother who's 8 years older than me too. So to have that kind of that split, especially when you're like, you know, I guess a child of the '80s, to have that little bit of the '70s like information like given to you by a sibling, I think it informs you, especially if you're involved in music. It informs you in a certain kind of special way, I guess, in a way. I don't know if it was the same for you, but...
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, like, I thought it was a special thing, and then you talk to anybody, and everybody that had an older sibling, like, always got put on the crazy shit. But yeah, I mean, I got put on the, not just hip-hop, but, like, you know, like, the Pixies. I remember there was, because when I was, like, in my early, at like very early, like 11 and 12, 13, Spike was working at magazines.
Oh, right.
So he got tons of free CD mailers. So he would just, whenever he'd come to town or I'd see him, he'd just like come with this box of CDs and
the mad promos.
Yeah, exactly.
Because they had a magazine, Dirt Magazine, right?
Yeah.
And then Grand Royal as well. So,
yeah.
Obviously, you're getting a lot of great promos at that period of time.
Exactly. So. Yeah, and it was all these, and yeah, so that he just always put me on this stuff, like indie rock shit and hip hop shit, and yeah, and it was like I said, I feel like it was a great time for music too. You know,
when did you start going to shows in New York?
Well, you know,
where are you going out? I mean, obviously, you must have at some point.
Yeah, I was. I mean, the first show I went to. Actually, I went to Wetland before it closed. Spike brought me to like this like kind of indie rock show. It was like a band called Codeine and a band called Velocity Girl.
Oh,
which was a DC punk band.
Okay, cool.
And that was like the first show I remember going to. I just used, wow. He gave me like, I used his fake ID. I was like a man child, so I was able to like get into the show when I was like 13, just using his fake ID. Or using his ID. And yeah, that was definitely a memorable show. And then, yeah, I mean, then I didn't really start going to shows regularly until a little bit later because, you know, when I was a little bit older. But yeah, I definitely saw a lot of shows. I mean, the other thing, I think being a hip hop head at that time, and hip hop was so connected to jazz.
Right, right.
Because of what everyone was sampling. And then I started to get really into jazz. And there was actually a really like vibrant jazz scene in New York at the time, too, which, you know, because you were booking those people at the Knitting Factory time. But yeah, I started going out and seeing jazz and like people like Christian McBride and Roy Hargrove.
The incredible Roy Hargrove, yeah. He's just like one of a kind, man. I'm such a fan of that guy, man.
Yeah, he's
incredible.
He's sick. And then and like Joshua Redman too, that guy, do you know?
I'm not
that
hip
guy?
To him.
He's part of that same kind of scene. Brian Blades was this like incredible drummer.
Yes, definitely.
So, and actually later on I came into contact with Joshua Redman because he was playing with David Byrne on this, like they did this tour about like kind of playing all William Onyebor's music.
The Atomic Bomb thing.
And then I like met him a couple years ago because I went to go hang out with those guys when they were playing.
Nice.
That was pretty cool.
Yeah, New York, I mean, the access is, you know, unparalleled for so many things. So, yeah. So what, like, were you going to, like, did you go to, like, an arts high school, too? Like people, when you grow up in New York, you fall into that pretty quickly, right? Like, your path is sort of carved for you in a way, right?
I mean, it's funny because actually, like, for junior high and high school, my parents moved out to the suburbs, to Westchester County. And I was actually miserable. I hated it because I was just discovering how great, like, the cultural side of New York City is. And then I had to just go. I was in this, like, suburban place where the kids had no interest in going to shows. They just wanted to, like drink, like, keg parties or whatever. But I still was coming into the city all the time and seeing shit as much as possible. Like, I was really into, at the time, like, John Spencer, Blues Explosion was great. They had a residency in, I think, at Knitting Factory.
I think so, right? Too, yeah. That was definitely before my tenure there.
Yeah.
But, John Spencer also such, it's like him and, like, people like Roy Hargrove and John Spencer, they're these, like, New York sort of like underground icons that are so prolific and continue to be like so amazing. Like I've done a couple shows with John Spencer as like a promoter. He's just such a cool, you know, incredible musician. Did you do a record with him? Was he on one of your records?
I never did a record with him, but I did. I worked with Russell Simmons.
Yes.
And
great producer.
Yeah, great producer and drummer, like the drummer from John Spencer, like the fucking craziest, hardest hitting drummer ever. And he played on, I have this side project record with Karen O. Side project, like kind of project. It was just called Stop the Virgins.
Yeah, so that was like a musical too, or a play as well.
Yeah, right. Kind of like a psych opera is what Karen calls it. It's like a weird kind of dream logic opera thing, but there's not like sung dialogue. It's just our songs.
Right.
It's very weird and psychedelic, and I love it. It's something I'm really proud of. And Russell played on a couple of songs on that record.
Oh, tight. So that was a live, that happened as a live thing, like. But was it an album too?
We did an album actually. It was before, and this is kind of skipping ahead, but it's before. Right before we did Show Your Bones together, we did that. That was the first thing I ever worked on with Karen. Well, I did this. I did a song with Karen called Hello Tomorrow, and then right after that, she was like, hey, I'm in LA for a little while and we like get along really well. Do you want to try and just make some stuff? And we made this, we sort of started doing some stuff, and you know, we're both like big girl group kind of doo-wop fans. And that was kind of her concept. Like, let's do some group shit. So then, and then that ended up kind of becoming this girl group record called Stop the Virgins. And
yeah, because that's not that long ago, right? I mean, this is like in the
2005,
last... 2005. Right, so yeah, okay. Yeah, well, time flies.
Yeah. So I don't know even how we got on. Russell played on that amongst a bunch of other crazy people.
Right.
It was a really crazy cast of like revolving door musicians coming through.
Yeah.
and making that record.
So, I mean, yeah, I mean, it's so easy to kind of get quickly, like talking about your studio work and your production work. It's really, I see how we can quickly fall into all these kind of reference points. But were you even dabbling in any kind of production or working with artists like when you lived here, when you were growing up here? Like,
When I was like 18 or 17 or 18, I started DJing when I was like pretty young.
So it started with DJing.
Yeah, started with DJing, and then like even in junior high and stuff, and then I started making beats in high school, and like when I was 18, I think I started making beats. Me and my homeboy found this like a long abandoned room in the arts part of our high school, uh-huh. And there was like a computer there. Actually, it wasn't when I was 18. It was when I was 15. Was the first time we discovered this room, and it was some archaic Apple program that I don't even know what it's called. I have no idea, but we just started making beats, and it was really silly. It was like, I remember like the early shit where like we made this one like rap battle beat out of like dog barking sounds or whatever. Like, it was just some like we were just doing whatever.
Well, yeah, I mean, you had to work with what you had, right? So, but I mean, so you were DJing, so where were you going? Were you doing just parties in people's cribs, or was it?
No, parties, and even like, you know, like getting, I mean, this was in junior high and shit, like we played like the high school dance.
Nice,
like,
yeah. School functions.
We made like mixtapes and sold them in school. I had a homeboy who was like kind of my DJ partner.
What'd you guys go by?
J&S Mix Productions.
Nice.
His name was Jeff. I actually still have a card somewhere that we like made in the print shop.
You sell the tapes?
No, man, I don't. Bad. I don't have the tapes. I gotta get those.
Yeah. Is that also obviously what this is, like mid-90s, you know?
This was early night. That was like so early. So
the height of the New York mixtape culture, which was like a thriving thing. I mean, with like Tape Kings and like, you know, Stretch Armstrong and, you know, SNS, Clark Kent, Kid Capri, Ron G. Like, these guys are like the titans of the New York mixtape thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's dope. You were cutting, blending records and shit, or what?
Not too much, just, man. Just
dropping joints?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, I'm just trying to get
not
a picture
yet.
Of
not
it.
Not yet.
Yeah.
No, we were just more just dropping shit. But, you know, I mean, I was like 13.
So. Yeah, I know. Well, yeah. Yeah, for sure. It's going to be a little raw, you know? where does that go from there? You.
Well, then, yeah, so I don't know, started making beats with my friend, and then I was out in LA every summer, like just staying with my brother and doing internships out there and stuff. And
like music internships?
No, mostly film stuff. Like, I was like, I like interned at an editing house under Eric Zumbrennan, who Spike still works with.
Amazing.
I still his editor. One summer, I like shrink pack skateboards as girl skateboards, you know, for the summer. I just hung out and skated a lot. And like,
nice.
Can
you edit?
I did edit something once, but now I work with the editor.
Yeah,
I
need
to get something edited.
Because back then, too, it was the toll, like, I mean, this is like a very different era for editing, too.
Yeah.
Optical printers and shit like that, and like cutting tape and shit.
Well, not yet. I just got Final Cut Pro, like on a G4, and I was like able to edit. So that's the early thing I edited was just on that, you know. But and where else? I like interned on sets and stuff, and you know, and generally did that. And then I moved to LA when I was 18. Because I thought I could get some work from some of the internships I had, and I was able to do that. I got like some PA jobs and stuff for production assistant jobs from some of the internships I had had, and then I like started meeting people, and actually never even thought about music being like a profession. You know, it was like never, I kind of dabbled in, I made a bunch of like short films in high school, and I was like, oh, maybe I'll be a director, you know. I didn't really give a shit, actually. I was just like, oh, whatever, right. Who cares, we'll see. And then, but music was always something that was came so naturally, and I never even thought about it. And then I made this song with a homeboy, and I was like, whoa, wait, maybe I could actually like do this. And around that same time, I met Fat Lip from Far Side, and, right. and started like giving him beats all the time, and took me 20 beats, and then finally there was one that he was like, all right, I'll fuck with this one.
Right. And this is already like post Far Side for Fat Lip, right?
Yeah,
Fat Lip. This is like in his Loneliest Punk was the
Loneliest Punk, yeah.
And What's Up Fat Lip, that was the first joint, right?
Yeah, I met him when they were doing the video for What's Up Fat Lip.
Wow. Did your brother do that video?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, people were like, yo, what's up with that dude? Like, he's like on some totally other shit now. Yeah. Like,
everybody said he smoked crack. That was the thing. Everybody right. was always talking about, oh, Fat Lip smokes crack. I never saw him smoke crack. He actually has a funny line in a song we did for that record where he's like, who said I'm smoking crack? You's a motherfucking liar!
So you met him right around that time.
I met him when they were shooting that. Yeah. So I had this like apartment that it was part of this old lady's house. We paid me and my homeboy, who actually ended up being a crack addict while we were staying there, paid like $450 to like live in her top floor.
Wow.
And we were in the place. The entrance to our apartment was like in the back of this house, and there was a knock at the door. And I opened the door, and there's this dude out there, and he had like a little bit of weird, like leftover white makeup because he was wearing the clown makeup earlier that day. And I was like, hey man, what's up? And I didn't recognize him, you know. And even I was a huge Far Side fan, like I had every word from Bizarre Ride 2 memorized, you know.
Yeah.
And but I didn't recognize him at the door. Like, it's just this weird dude out of context wearing like kind of a little bit of white. And I was like, yo, what's up, man? And it wasn't like you just walk in off the street and like come to our door. You have to go like around this old lady's house. And he's like, hey, I'm from the Mormon church. And like my brother is like hiding in the woods with a camera. and he's like, I really think, you know, you need to give Jesus a chance. And, like, he's just, like, and I was like, yeah, man, no, that, you know, that's cool. You know, I respect that you're out here doing this. And,
right.
And he just wouldn't let me go.
Wow.
And then finally, like, after, like, what felt like an hour-long conversation, was probably more like 5 minutes, like, my brother and my homeboy Benzo came out of the woods, like, laughing with the camera. Then me and Fat Lip ended up becoming like really great friends and doing a lot of shit together.
Yeah.
But it was a tough, it was like, I felt that was like my producer college, because as far as like mental, Fat Lip was, it was very dark times for him.
Yeah.
And,
clearly, I mean, the music and his, his voice had changed, altered a little bit too.
Yeah.
The subject matter too. Yeah. I'm trying to remember that time, because it was like, a lot of people were confused about him.
Yeah, I mean, he's amazing dude. He's so intelligent and fun and like funny, but it was like the darkest I've known him ever, like that era. And I was going through it with him, you know, because I was like, come on, man. Like, I just wanted to produce him, and I was like, so wanted to do that. And so it was almost like I kind of went through a lot of that pain with him, just but it taught me a lot about, like, after that era of working with him, I could work with anybody and have no, like, the patience and the kind of wherewithal to know, to deal with. He was the most complicated person you could ever work with.
Really?
During that period. And so it kind of made me be like, oh, wow, like, I'm not afraid to work with anybody, no matter how complicated they are, because I've navigated like the stormiest of seas.
Do you think, could you see if that period of work for him and doing those songs was like therapeutic for him? Did it come to a point where he wanted to keep going, or was it really like you had to like really like get him in the right headspace to be artistically productive or to finish songs or whatever it might be. Like, did you guys have a good back, like, trade-off, like, in that artistically?
I mean, it was definitely therapeutic. I feel like he was fighting a lot of his darkest demons through that record that he made. Right. And
it's pretty slept on too now. Kind of, if you look back, as far as like a rap record of that era, you know.
Yeah.
Emotionally.
Yeah. And shit. I mean, he's so real. Like, he's the realest dude. He will say anything. He's so honest. You know, that's what's so great about him. You know, you hear it in "What's Up, Fat Lip" and. And a bunch of those songs, you know, today's your day, what you gonna do, that song, or, like, he's so honest, he definitely was fighting through his demons through that record, and, I think everybody around, it was hard on him, it was the hardest on him, but I think anybody around him, it was hard on Delicious Vinyl, and those dudes, and it was definitely hard on me, but it was a good. He kind of like put me through producer school in a cool way, where I was like, he prepared me to work with. Artists, musicians are complicated people and can be pretty dark people sometimes, and I feel like he kind of prepared me for that.
Where did you go from there? Like, I'm trying to remember this too, because NASA was still a couple of years off from that, right?
Yeah, NASA hadn't started yet.
You even squeaky clean at that point in time? Like, with the
I was so squeaky. Yeah, I picked up that name around that same time.
Where did that come from?
I have no idea.
It disappeared.
Right. Yeah. I wish I had a better story for that. I don't even remember when I came up or how I came up with that, but. But yeah, around that same time, I started doing music for, like, I did Yeah Right. Like that skate film.
Yep.
That Spike did. It was Spike and Ty Evans, and it was like this great girl, kind of classic girl skate film, and I did the opening music for that and all the original music, and actually one of the Fat Lip songs that I'd been working on was in that film too.
Right.
For the Pink Board sketch.
So this is like your first time really scoring something, then, right?
Yep. Yeah. It was the very first time I ever scored anything, and it was the opening credits, and it was like, and it was awesome. And I mean, it really started my career as like doing music to picture was from that film. And
and now looking back, I mean, there's more of that, I guess, than the. You know, physical records and stuff. Like, you've become like this very prolific composer, if you will, for shorts and for film and for commercial work and stuff like that. I mean, it's pretty dope, because you have to kind of dig a little bit more for that, for the average person to find that stuff, because it's not the same presented to people in the same way as a record would be, you know. So I know this might be jumping ahead a little bit too, but there's that Kanye West short that you had some, which I think you did this piano on and stuff. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
The fairy tale one?
Yes. What was it called again? It was
something like We All Have a Fairy Tale or something. I don't know if I...
Yeah.
I watched it recently, and the shit, I never even knew it existed, you know?
Yeah.
I think your brother had worked on that too. And it's just like this sort of, he's acting in a short. And he, like, you know, cuts his, you know, it's this whole transpires over an evening, I suppose, like an after party, seemingly. I don't know any of the backstory. I know it must have been connected to 808 and Heartbreaks or something like that, because you can tell from the gear he's wearing, like, what era he might be in.
Yeah, I think that's right. Yeah.
But it's just, a pretty dark short film.
Yeah.
But I know you scored that, right?
Yeah, I did. I did score that, and I actually did this other. The way I met Kanye was through. I did, like, he has this video version of Flashing Lights.
Uh-huh.
That it was like they did like a horror video.
Really?
And Spike had just met him, and then he was saying he has this video and he wants to do a cinematic horror remix of the song to fit the video, because the video didn't fit the song. And so then I ended up doing that, and then Kanye, like, loved my remix so much. But then he had beef with the filmmakers who and so he never released this video. And I was always, it was great because I love this. I love the remix I did for it. And
is that, can you find the remix?
I have the remix, but it never came out. You know, wow. So I was like, yay, dude, let's put this shit out.
And he's like, yeah, no, I mean, flashing lights. Dudes. Yeah, that's probably one of his most popular songs.
Yeah, know? Yeah, it killed me that it never came out, but it was cool anyway because then it was like he loved it so much, and then he brought me on to work on his Glow in the Dark tour and do a bunch of shit with him.
What was that. Yeah? What was I remember that was what Neptunes was on that, right? And
Nerd.
Yes,
it was course. Nerd and Rihanna.
So what was your involvement on the tour? Were you performing? I mean, were you
I music directed the tour. So
amazing.
Like, yeah. So when I met him, it was kind of before he was really like this incredible touring artist. I think it was kind of the
totally.
Beginning of that.
Yeah.
He had this band and it was all really great musicians, but it was like, there wasn't like, after that, every tour, like this was the start of him being like, okay, this tour is going to have this insanely strong concept. And his show before that, it was called the Glow in the Dark Tour, but it was like a band and it was very like noodly and right. like, you know, and it wasn't super like thought out. And so we got rid of the entire band actually. And we did like, we basically remixed all of his songs.
Uh-huh. For a live show.
It was almost like, it was like Star Wars or Blade, like Star Wars / Blade Runner versions of all of the Kanye West songs with interludes and stuff, and there was a whole story, like, and it's just him on stage.
Right.
It's just him on stage, and it's like he crash lands on this planet, and then he's trying to figure out with his spaceship, who's voiced by Estelle. Is uh-huh. that her name?
Yep.
Estelle, yeah. Voice by her, and he's, you know, trying to figure out how to get off this planet that he's crash landed on. But yeah, we remixed like the
whole. Is this post A-Track?
This is just when A-Track left.
Right. Like, interesting. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So we crossed paths just in that, like, A-Track was hanging out a lot right in the beginning when I was there.
Yeah.
But he had just stopped being Ye's DJ.
Yeah. So because that's a pretty interesting creative turning point for Kanye too, where he is kind of graduating from that semi-traditional hip-hop style of hip-hop with a band style of show.
Yeah.
Because I didn't see that. Now, the first time I ever really saw him do a real, like, real deal show, admittedly, was like a real concert in an arena was Yeezus.
Right.
So as far as catching him live in that kind of setting. This is the first time he would be a singular person, individual on stage. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Interesting.
This, I think it was the beginning of, like, yeah, him being, like, the greatest live touring act in the world, in my opinion. But Yeezus, you caught a good one, though. That was a great...
Yeah, I saw it at the Garden.
Tour.
Yeah.
Sick.
Yeah, incredible.
Right. Was that the one where... Did Busta come out?
Nah, this was... Because they did two nights or four nights. I'm trying to remember. It was when Kendrick Lamar opened.
Okay.
Because I really wanted to see the Tribe one, because it was Tribe Called Quest and Kendrick Lamar were the kind of split openers just for the Garden.
Yeah.
But I wasn't there when Busta came out.
Yeah.
You were there?
I wasn't there, no. I heard
that
about it.
That would have been tight.
I heard it was sick.
Yeah, I don't doubt it. Yeah. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Yeah, that's amazing. So working with him, it was a good rapport?
It was great, man.
He's open?
You know, it was weird, because I had met him earlier. I met him with Mark Ronson randomly, like, on his first album, and I didn't know anything about him, and I was like, and he was really cool and well-spoken, and like, and I was like, he's really humble, man.
Right.
And then Mark was like, dude, that guy's not humble. Or he's like, I don't know, I don't think he said that. He was just like, dude, that, it's funny you say that, because that guy has a rep for being like the most unhumble, like, person. But
I guess it depends on who you vibe with. You know?
Yeah, because then later on when I worked with him, you know, I found him to be very humble too. You know, I felt like he always shouted me out. I felt like he gave me a lot of props whenever he could.
That's what's up.
And to everybody around him that was helping him, I felt like he wasn't the type of person that was like, this is my shit, and like.
Right.
You know, like, he always shouted out people around him. I haven't, like, worked with him for a long time or really hung out with him for a while.
Sure.
But at the time, I felt like he was a really... He actually kind of even admitted to me. He's like, yo, all that shit I do, like, it's kind of like a shtick. Like,
yeah, it's, you know, part all that, of the persona, right?
Yeah, and he's like, you know, I just do that to stir people up, you know?
Well, if you watch that short, too, it's kind of interesting to watch that short, the fairy tale thing. I can't remember the full title. But to see him actually acting as if an actor in a film, which he is in that case... And how much he gives, because he's pretty, he exposes himself in a very interesting way. You see that different kind of side, because when you're a musician on stage, people don't want to really consider you an actor. You know, they want it to be real as possible. But, yeah. You know, I mean, this guy is like, he has to be an actor. I mean, it's so over the top, you know, but anyway, like, that's cool. I mean, that's great to even have like a chapter in your career as a composer and an arranger and stuff, because that goes beyond like a producer. When you start really like you were picking and dictating the orchestra, I mean the band and all that stuff too, or
well, we didn't really have a band, so we actually, the whole show was recorded beforehand, so
interesting.
Basically we just remixed, but with an orchestra and with taiko drums and with
you, like, were there for all that?
Yeah.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah. Actually, I brought the taiko drums in, and then Kanye ended up like loving the taiko drums so much.
Oh,
he used them so much, like, and he's been still using them, you know.
Oh wow! So there's still remnants of that today in his.
A little bit, yeah. Just the taiko stuff, like he fucking loves taikos, and yeah, I just like brought in all my synths and like kind of orchestra chops and
dope.
And
dope.
Yeah, basically remixed his show.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah, it's really fun.
I was when I was looking through some stuff too, I didn't realize, did you produce Crystal Castle's record?
Yeah, debut.
I had no idea. That's interesting, because that made a pretty big impact when they first came out. I mean, they kind of had a tumultuous history after that, you know.
Yeah.
So how did that come together?
It was through a manager I was working with at the time. She like showed me they had an EP out, I think.
Oh yeah.
And she showed me their stuff on MySpace, and you know, I was like, whoa, this is unique. Like,
yeah, they were on some shit.
Yeah, and I really liked it, and it just ended up, they ended up coming out and staying with me and for like a while, and we just recorded a ton of shit and
dope.
And it was great. I love those guys. It was really they're really fun people.
Yeah,
it's funny because they, at the time, and I feel like there was this, yeah, used to be like this a little bit too. And they Crystal Castles was even more extreme. They just hated everyone.
Right.
But like when they love you, they like really love you. Right, so right. It was like, I don't know. It was always fun because then it would. It was great fun producing that record with them, and you know, it was not that there weren't challenges, but it was really fun, and I just like loved the dudes. And then whenever I see them still to this day, I just saw them in Tokyo a few weeks ago. Randomly, I didn't even know they were there.
Amazing.
But it's always just like a love fest because they're so awesome. They're just fun people.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, I was totally surprised because I didn't realize, and it's you were involved with like most of the songs on the record.
Yeah,
a good chunk of it. So.
Yeah, I worked on a lot of it. Yeah, that was fun.
What was the record that we tried to do here in New York? Which I think we were all in a recording studio, or it was when I was managing Sadat X, Brand Nubian. I know it's a song that never got on. I think it was for NASA, if I'm not mistaken. And if I'm not mistaken, too, one, I think the song was completed, but I think was it not Sadat X and Slick Rick together?
Slick Rick was supposed to come, but he didn't show up at the studio that day. It was going to be maybe Slick Rick, and then also, like, Slick Rick, it was kind of weird, shady shit. I don't know. We were trying to get Slick Rick. We weren't sure if he was going to come, and then at one point, Bismarck Key was going to come, but it was like, I don't know, I feel like it was like that era hip-hop MC shit where it was just like...
You might get him, you might not get
him. Yeah, exactly. But Sadat showed up, and it was actually interesting because it was Sadat was going to jail the next day.
I didn't realize it was the next day. Yeah,
the
I
next
mean that was
day.
We did a lot of stuff leading up to when he went to jail. In fact, during that whole period of time, I did two albums with him, Experience and Education and Black October. Black October titled that because that's when he was going to jail for a year. And I know that we had a very prolific period of time before he went to jail so that we could
earn money and be and have stuff happening while he was locked up, you know?
Yeah.
And I did not realize that the next day he was going to jail.
Yeah.
I don't think I was with him. I don't remember being in the studio.
I don't think you were there either.
So what was the vibe like?
It was cool. He was kind of like real introspective and talking about it. And then I was like, man, we should just do it. Like, that's what this record should be about, right. You know? Because it was clearly on his mind. I mean, he was about to go to jail for a year. So, yeah, he was really cool, man. He was just a classy dude and, right. like, cool, nice dude. And he went there, you know, with them. I mean, I think it wasn't easy to talk about that probably on record, or right. maybe it was, but he went right. there, you know.
So nothing. So the track just sort of never really materialized.
No, I still have it. You know, amazing. Like, just never finished it. Yeah.
And no one else ever got on it too.
No.
That's cool. You have a snapshot though of this sketch in time of this guy in a certain place in his life that, in any other circumstance, he's just been another hip hop track with a couple of cats on it, like a cool sort of match up and stuff, but instead you have this thing that maybe it was never meant to come out because of that too. That's dope. I love to hear it sometime. I don't think I ever heard it too.
Yeah, so, man, I'll send it to
yeah.
you.
Yeah, because we don't work together in that magnitude anymore, but that's still my man, and that period of time was one I remember. It's a lot, probably not that different from your work with Fatlip too, where it's like you learn a lot through the challenges and shit too.
Huh.
Yeah, except I wasn't an actual music producer. I was more like the manager, like yeah. gathering as much stuff, you know, under various states of duress.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, that could be even more challenging.
Oh, tell me about it, man. It's the story of my life.
I was always like a big Grand Poobah fan growing up.
Of course, yeah.
And it seemed like that dude.
The original Kanye West.
Real complicated shit, too, right?
Yeah. Brand Nubian, all the members of Brand Nubian are very. Complex people that I think that's always makes their music so, like, especially, you know, those first three or four albums of theirs are, I think they're some of the greatest hip hop records, you know. Yeah, Poobah is very interesting. Yeah, for sure. I love Brand Nubian. Yeah, I went out, I DJed for them on tour a couple times, and yeah, we did a bunch of stuff over the years for sure. I want to talk a little bit more about your primary stuff too, like NASA, for example, because that was such a big record, and that was obviously, you know, big chapter of your life too, because there's really just the one album, right, if I'm not mistaken, or was there two?
No, there's just one. Well, there's like a remix record album, though, right. Yeah,
so now that group also just sort of existed as a project in a period of time. It doesn't really, you guys don't really do stuff anymore, or do you?
No, we don't. I mean, I kept doing, so yeah, that was just a project, you know, me and Zagon did.
Where's that dude? He's not from the U.S., right?
He's Brazilian, right. Yeah. And he's actually killing it now, because he has this group, he has this like DJ thing with his, with a partner in Brazil now called Trop Killers.
Really?
It's like amazing, man. It's so good.
What's the vibe like?
It's like, well, because it's like electronic music. There's a lot of like, you know, trap elements and right. like electronic trap elements, Moomba tone. Now they're doing a lot of Bailey, because
sure.
by the Bailey funk scene is so hot now. But Zagon is such a deep hip hop head, so like anything he touches is always going to have some like a lot of hip hop influence right. in it.
So when, with the NASA stuff, who was bringing the more hip hop vibe to it? Because there's a lot of hip hop artists involved
yeah,
with it too.
We both were, you know, right. we were both hip hop heads, you yeah. know, and are both at our cores hip hop heads. So you know, I think yeah, both of us brought that. You know, I think Zagon like really like. Put me on to like great MPC chops. That whole record is pretty right. much MPC, you know.
Uh-huh.
I don't think there's any songs on the entire record. Maybe at the very end there might have been one that we did without the MPC. Everything was MPC 2000XL.
Also, I mean, how much is it being samples? Are you playing stuff and then sampling yourself? Like, is it one of those?
It was all, every song on the record started with a sample at least. Dope. You know,
okay.
So a lot of times we took the samples out, you know, but they all started with samples from these, like, Zay had this really, sorry.
Hit the pause.
Okay. Zagon had a really crazy Brazilian funk and soul record collection, you know, very specific, right. like, there in Brazil, like, they did a lot of great funk and soul shit, that, but it was like, it was always like a little later than all the stuff here, you know? So like the late 70s shit was still super vibrant and like, and just fire vital, like,
yeah. Sorry, I'm gonna sneeze. Okay.
Yeah, so Zagon had he had this crazy record collection. So we all the songs started with a Brazilian sample, you know. And then I had like a really crazy synth, have a really crazy synth collection. And
oh, really? Okay.
The longer we worked on the record, the more those, the synth collect, the record took 5 years to make.
Did it? I did not realize
that. Yeah. So the synth collection was piling up the whole time. And the deeper you get in the record, the more you kind of hear the synths that were piling up in my house.
So what kind of like, so I wish I was a little more adept to it, but with my years of working with Dame Funk, I mean, I know I have like a pretty good sense of like analog synths and stuff like that. Like, where do you, what's your go-to now? Like, what do you, I mean, obviously you still must use them quite a bit. Like what's your brand? Are you like a Roland dude, or are
you like, I mean, I love Moog shit. I love Roland shit. I love everything.
Yeah.
I mean,
use different things for different purposes, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, like, on that record, there's, a, like, for instance, on Gifted is Jupiter 8. Gifted is a song with Kanye and Licky Lee and Santi Gold. But that song, it's Jupiter 8, Memory Moog, and OB8.
Nice.
So, yeah. Yeah. That was a good combination for me. That was, like, kind of my... And then ARP 2600 too. That was like, those four were kind of my main, at that era, were kind of my main go-tos.
So, and I remember you were, during that time, you were touring too. You guys did you had a run. You did the festivals and like the, you kind of had a good run as like a live act. But I don't think I ever peeped the show or had a chance to. So obviously you got an album with like a bunch of high-profile guests that they all can't, you know, Tom Waits isn't just going to sit in, like, you know, on a show unless it's a special thing or something like that. So how does it translate? How did you do it live? Like, what did you do live?
Well, we generally brought, like, I mean, we had different shows. We had, like, just a DJ show, which was more like a club thing.
Right.
And then we had our, like, festival, like, hard ticket venue kind of thing, which was... You know, we had dancers at various stages of the show. For a while, we linked up with this guy who was out of RISD that made all RISD. These crazy prosthetic, like, alien suits.
Okay.
And every tour, he would show up with, like, a host of new different alien suits. And then, so we had alien dancers. Like, every show, depending on that iteration of the show or that leg of the tour, it was kind of different aliens.
Yeah, makes sense, yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we were NASA. So we had our kind of main spaceship that we built, and then we DJ'd off of that. It was this kind of crazy replica of, like, like the Eagle Has Landed kind of lander. And then Fat Lip toured with us a lot.
Really?
He was in a really good place during those.
Well, he did a couple joints on the album, right?
Yeah. And then this guy Ross Congo, who was on the album too, he toured with us quite a bit. And then, yeah, various legs. You know, we brought, like, you know, Amanda Blank. We brought her to, like, China with us, and we had different people played it. Cool Keith did a show with us.
Nice. I just saw Dr. Octagon night before last.
Oh yeah,
Irving Plaza.
I wanted to see that. How was
cool.
it?
It was the nostalgia level was way high. You know, it was at 1,000 and climbing. But I really liked it. I thought they were. He was. Everyone on stage was really very present. It wasn't dialed in by any means. Okay. It was dope. I mean, and it was just. I think Automator got on the mic at one point in time in the show and said, "This is our first time ever playing in New York," which seemed somewhat inconceivable, but. Right. I guess when the record came out, they weren't, like,
they
doing mad shows.
It.
Yeah. So in that regard, it was pretty amazing, like, to hear, like, Bear Witness, to see them do Bear Witness live, or, like, Girl Let Me Touch You live, and, like, you know, just all those joints, 3000 and all. They just knocked hella hard. He obviously brought the front of house, and they had the right people doing sound, because it knocked, like, because it was just... They were just running beats, but they had, like, a bass player, and I think they had a guy, like, on a small kit.
Qbert, too, right?
Of course. Yeah. 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 With NASA, did you also did a joint with Old Dirty. Was he around during that time?
Nah, man. As far as I know, it's the last ever Old Dirty voice recorded. Because after like a month or something after we recorded him, he passed away.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That was a song with
Karen O.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, did that. And then Karen and I were working on, I believe that was during... I think that might have been during Show Your Bones, actually, when we were working on her album. And yeah, I just asked her if she wanted to be on that. And she obviously loves Dirt McGirt and got on the record. And, it ended up kind of being about, like, the song to me is kind of about, like, self-destruction. And
well, I mean, someone would argue he was somewhat self-destructive person,
At the time, I think Karen was able to kind of through the making of that record that we made together, she was tasting that same thing, you see that a lot. I feel like in musicians, and it's like a common theme.
Yeah, absolutely. There's some element of that, in order to keep them going or find. Or, to slow things down. I don't know. I mean, it's different for everyone. The chemistry, and like, especially once you're like a public figure and the pressure that comes with that to always deliver. Yeah, the psychology behind that is pretty, pretty wild, I think. Yeah. You've been in the studio more than I have. Now I'm more behind the scenes. But in the studio with someone, when you see them like in the booth or whatever, then... Yeah, you really can see the real crux of it right there.
Yeah,
right?
The struggle. Yeah, it's hard. I mean, Karen, I think doing, Show Your Bones was a really hard record for all those guys to make, that band. Yeah. And they were really feeling the pressure of, like they had this huge hit first album and they're on a major label now and everyone's waiting. And yeah, I think, there's a lot of pressure and it's hard, especially as, Karen wants to, everything she does is great and she fights for that so hard, she doesn't do a lot, she's not super prolific. Every single thing she does is like so thought out and so completely realized and I think when you hold yourself to that highest standard, it's hard. I mean, you see, even with Kanye or whatever, you see, it's like the dude is going crazy making greatness,
Yeah, the insanity level, intensity level, rather, especially with someone that doesn't constantly turn out material, like people don't really see the process because it's so hidden behind studio walls or whatever, their mind. Yeah, I gotta, Yeah's are definitely a very, like, special kind of group in a way because, one, I had an amazing experience with them in that I did this benefit concert some years ago for Jonathan Tobin, who's a New York-based DJ, who was, like, tragically, like, hit by a car when he was sleeping in a hotel room.
Yeah, so
that's a buddy of mine. And quickly, I, like, assembled this, like, benefit concert, and I asked them if they'd play, and it was... period of time when they hadn't played a show in like 2 years or some shit like that. It'd been a while, and but wanted to try to find like a meaningful headliner to, because it was a benefit to raise money for this guy who didn't have health insurance and he was crushed by a car and he's a New York fixture, and each individual member of the Yeah's do their own thing in New York. Like I did a bunch of shows with Brian Chase at the Knitting Factory, these like sort of out jazz shows and shit.
Yeah.
And they came together and they did it. They headlined the show and they hadn't played a show in mad long. They were like very generous. And I always remember that because, you can easily say like, oh, we're not really ready to play or something. And I think they just like, just said, fuck it and did it. And it like, we were able to like give the guy like 60 grand at the end of the show. That shit saved his fucking life.
Yeah,
saying?
Amazing.
So I got to give them a shout out. Thank you for doing that.
Yeah, I love those dudes. That's family.
Yeah, cool. So what do you have going on now? Because we tried to link up a couple times in the last month or so, and you come to New York pretty frequently, right? But it's usually for you're working out of studios here, or what's the Your family's here too, yes? So.
Yeah, my family's here. I've been here a lot lately. Like, I was here. This time I'm here. I was here for, like, this award show.
Yeah, yeah. So tell me about it.
It was for, it's called AICP. It's like an advertising award show, but we ended up winning for this song we did for this Kenzo ad with Spike.
Yes, which is dope. Oh, did he direct it?
Yeah, he directed
awesome.
It.
Awesome, yeah. Great. I like that ad.
Cool, thank you.
And that, the actress whose name I can't recall,
Margaret Qualley.
Yes. Yeah. She's dope, and I love her from The Leftovers. She has such a reserved role in that, but to see her, she must be a trained dancer or ballerina or something.
She was a dancer before she started acting.
Like I see.
And then she started acting, but she spent a lot of time doing dance.
She killed it.
Yeah, she's great.
What's the track? It's like a dance hall track you did, right?
It's like a dance hall bashment track. It was really fun. Did it with my boy Ape Drums and then we went down to Jamaica, and I went down to Jamaica and recorded Assassin, who's like one of my favorite dance vocalists. And it was really fun. It was a great process, and people seem to really like the record. There's all these, there are so many dance videos that people have made since it came out. Both
to the track.
To the track.
Dope.
Some of them are like little kids copying exactly all of Margaret's dance moves, and then some of them are just like dance crews and wherever they may be, Jamaica or wherever, like just doing new dances to it. But yeah, people seem to really embrace this one.
It's a big tune, a big club tune.
Yeah,
that's what's up, man. So beyond that, I mean, what? Because last time you were here, you were doing something for National Geographic, right?
Yeah, I started directing. The way I started directing was like, so I was saying a little earlier with NASA, you know, how like, you know, we did this one record together and toured it extensively. And then I put out like a handful of just singles with NASA kind of at the very end of the project. And Zegon had already kind of moved on and was doing his thing in Brazil with Tropkillers. Mm-hmm. But the last one I did was a song called Jihad Love Squad. And and it was kind of my first time really taking a crack at directing something. And I actually like flew out to India just myself and solo, and decided I was going to direct this video for it. The concept for the video kind of came with the writing of the song. The song, it has KRS on it, but actually like me and my homeboy wrote the lyrics, which was weird because like KRS was like, wait, you want me to rap? You don't want me to write? You just want me to rap these lyrics? And we're like, yeah. It's like, okay, that's weird. You know I'm KRS-One.
Right. amazing.
We're like, yeah, we know, but we really love this concept. And he was kind of got on board with the concept, which was like kind of a very political. It was kind of about, really about like the kind of parody between the world of Islam and the world of the West now, and kind of taking it to having a different, more kind of take on, have a positive, more nuanced take on that rather than just like feeding into this like really bad stereotype and kind of polarizing force that I feel like the media has kind of taken with the way the media has polarized, you know, the two worlds. So yeah, so the concept for the video kind of came when we were writing it, and yeah, I just decided to go out to India and direct it, and got my whole cast and crew out there, and then from that,
where in India?
It was in Mumbai,
right?
Which is the fucking craziest city I've ever been to.
Weather there? It's pretty crazy, right?
It was so
smoky,
hot,
right?
It was like right before monsoon season. So that it just gets hotter and hotter and hotter and more humid until just then all of a sudden it just starts raining for like 2 months or whatever.
Holy shit.
So it was so intense. The city is just so intense, and it was an intense shoot, but it was so fun. I mean,
did you shoot indoors and outdoors? Or like
all outdoors.
Jesus. Really?
And on the street too, and it's like the most crowded place. You know, it's literally like the most crowded place in the world. Like,
do you have to get permits for that or what?
It's a lot of backsheesh, which is their version of bribing. You know, you get permits, but the permits aren't as important as paying off like the local gangsters in the whatever neighborhood you're shooting at, and paying the cops. You have to like there's this whole backsheesh item in the budget for like just handing out cash to people.
Yeah, it's just petty cash, breaking cats off left and right.
Exactly.
So,
like, yo, can you make sure nobody fucks with us? And this, you know,
how big of a crew did you have?
Well, the crews there are huge. Like, really? I was like, because I guess it's such a like low price of labor there, I was like, why is there like 20 people in a camera department, you know? Not that I knew, because it was like kind of my first time directing, but I was like, there's so many people working on this set.
Yeah.
And the producer's like, no, it's fine, man, don't worry. Like, that's just how it goes here. The crews are huge.
Like, and it worked? It worked out like
yeah,
that?
Yeah, it was amazing, man. It was so fun. I'm so proud of the video, you know. But it was an interesting experience because, like, I went out to do this video, and it was very politically charged. When I brought the video back to L.A. and showed it to my manager was like, oh, whoa, and my manager freaked out.
Really?
And ultimately, my manager was like, if you put this video out, I can't work with you anymore.
Dang, okay. Well, so...
And I was like, sorry, you know, I have to put the video out, you know? And to be fair, like, she read the treatment and everything, you know?
Yeah.
And, like, before I went out there, she knew what I was going to make. But I guess she didn't realize how powerful it was going to be, and it freaked her out. And then same thing with my publicist at the time, too. Like, they both kind of, like, just boycotted it.
Did they bail on you? Or
they bailed.
Wow.
Yeah.
So the industry couldn't handle it.
They couldn't handle it. And so I just put it out anyway because I was like, I have to put this out, you know. And they were really afraid that, like, the Muslim press was going to kind of... They were afraid that... My manager was like, I'm afraid someone is going to hurt me if I'm associated with this.
Oh, so they were more concerned about their own reputation.
And they thought that people were going to be pissed at me and all this stuff. And I just feel like they... I felt like overall there wasn't like a lot of credit given to people's intelligence.
Yeah, that happens.
Yeah.
For sure.
They were just like, oh, it's jihad. It's about jihad. Everyone, like, this is fucked up, you know, versus like, no, this is nuanced and thoughtful.
Right.
And you know, like, let's give people credit to, like, look in a little deeper, you know, and actually, like, so we had no publicity for it or anything. And the only people that picked it up was, like, actually the Muslim press picked it up and loved it.
Huh.
Which is exactly what they were terrified of. The only people that got pissed were like Islamophobe, like little like right wing Islamophobe groups that were like, this fucking guy is making excuses for the jihadists and, you know, da da da, which I wasn't doing at all, but, you know, they just got pissed but fuck those guys anyway.
Yeah.
Like, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
But yeah, it was an interesting lesson, you know.
So you can find it though; it's out there though, right?
Yeah, it's on YouTube.
What's the name of the track again?
Jihad Love Squad.
Yeah, cool. Yeah.
And then so from that, I end up getting signed to a production company, to RSA, Ridley Scott's production company. Hey Wonderful is like a sub company there who are great people, and they kind of saw that and were like, whoa, I really like this. You know, this is. Do you want to direct more? And I was like, yeah, it was so fun. I love doing it. And then, yeah, then I'm on their roster now, and then these two short films came through for Nat Geo that were kind of loosely based around, inspired by Albert Einstein.
Hmm.
And
okay.
I'm like a big, you know, clearly like a big space dude, and I love science too, you know, like I want to be a scientist when I was a little kid. And so I don't know, it just kind of made sense. I had actually written like a short about Albert Einstein like a few months before that. So when it came through, my production company was like, hey, we should, you know, try and get Sam. And they kind of took a risk on me because I'd really only directed the one thing
right,
before.
Right.
But yeah, I went down and shot it. And yeah, they just came out last week.
Oh, cool.
And, yeah, it was fun, man. It was one of the greatest. I just love doing it.
Is it like this is like a documentary style thing, or is
no,
it actual?
It's kind of like an art film. Like, or there are two of them. There's two like kind of short films that are like art films. And yeah, I don't know. I had so much fun making them. And like literally, like I was on set several times. Like brought like close to tears. Like just like, this is so fucking fun. I love doing this.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
So I clearly gotta do that more. Anything that makes me feel like that is something that
yeah, absolutely.
Explored.
Well, after doing music for so long too, to be able to transfer some of that ability, you know, into filmmaking, which is not very different really when you come down to it. Like, yeah, it's gotta be exciting, especially if the opportunities are there. It's like, yo, you gotta like take them, you know,
yeah.
Like. When you're getting started too, I mean, so, yeah, I mean, what's is there something? What are you working on right now? Are you just
there's another directing project. So I put out my singles with Interscope now, or put out my music with Interscope. I put out the song from the Kenzo ad, the Mutant Brain song.
Oh, right, them. Nice.
And then I
that came out. So commercially, that's available.
Yeah, it came out, and it actually, yeah, it got a lot of love, which was great. It was fun to see.
It's on Interscope.
Yeah.
Proper. Oh, that's what's up, man.
Yeah, yeah.
Very nice.
They're great. Yeah, actually, I'm really happy with them. They've been. It's cool. My first time releasing. To be honest, I've done a lot of work as a producer with major labels and had not great experiences. You know, faced a lot of challenges and frustration. But so far, putting my own music out through a major has been great. I've been really happy with them, and so we got another single coming out really soon.
Dope.
With it's got CeeLo and Theophilus London and
cool.
And also Alex Ebert from Edward Sharpe and the Magnetic Zeros.
Oh, okay. So it's like kind of in line with some of the NASA, like, you know, you like bringing in multiple artists, right?
I think you can see in like almost in most of my, it might be like a theme through my art is like kind of bringing different worlds together, you know,
right.
It's kind of something I always like to do is I have such eclectic taste and love stuff from so many different places and types of music. I think it's like something that's kind of that my taste is kind of evident in all the stuff I do, where it's like I bring people together that you don't expect and that are disparate pieces.
Is that going to turn into an album? Or is that even something you're thinking about?
I love albums. I think in albums, the Interscope guys are not as keen on that thing. They're just like, why put out an album?
Right. You're, I guess, the major label mode now isn't really album driven. Right?
But I think in albums, I mean, the thing I'm really excited about right now is doing music and then directing stuff for my music, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's right now, like, my frame of mind for the next year is, like, put out a lot of songs and do great videos for them, you know?
Dope.
And so kind of developing the next video right now, too, which I'm really excited about for this song, To Whom It May Concern. And that'll be coming out in the next few weeks. And then I have, I have some other projects I'm kind of developing.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I noticed that now Squeaky Clean is, it like, evolved from, you know, a singular producer dude to, like, it's like a full-on, full-service, like, production company, basically, right? I mean, you got, like, a staff of multiple people.
Yep.
Other producers and stuff, too. Film producers, right?
Yeah, Squeaky Clean, not film producers, music
producers. All music producers.
It's all music Squeaky Clean is. And experiential. We're doing some, like, events and stuff like that.
Oh, cool.
But, yeah, Squeaky Clean has grown, and now it's this awesome thing. We got people in New York, Chicago, L.A., and we're doing, you know, like, it's fun because this year we're winning some awards for this Kenzo thing, which I did the music for, but, like, last year we won a bunch of awards for this Adidas spot that my boy Justin Horry at Squeaky Clean did the music for. You know, it's like... It's like all these talented people that are working together, and it's this really great, like, kind of family vibe and people, like, it's great because people come to Squeaky Clean because it's like there's actually like a bunch of companies that do music for commercials now, but
sure.
The people that gravitate to Squeaky Clean are like, know that we're gonna be working on like the dopest shit.
Well, it's artists run, right? Would you say?
Yeah, it's artists run, and exactly everywhere. I think like the most important thing to everyone there is like, let's just do great stuff and let's work on dope stuff and that's the mission, you know, more than like how much can we get paid.
Yeah, cuz I mean the money will come if you continue to make real good quality shit, you know. It's like you can take, of course you'll get this every once in a while those big checks might come or big opportunities, but you don't have to say yes to every single one of them too, because some of them could set you back a little bit creatively. So
that's
my interpretation.
I agree with that. Yeah. I mean, we do what excites us. I mean, I've been working with this guy, Jean-Paul Goud, quite a bit through Squeaky Clean lately, and that's been really fun.
The photographer?
Yeah.
Wow. Iconic.
Yes, exactly.
He's the one that shot the Grace Jones.
Wow. He was married to her, and he has a kid with her, actually. He shot all her album stuff, all like the Illy era Grace Jones stuff. This is art.
Yeah. Wow. What's that like?
Is he cool? Really awesome, man. I mean, he's 77, and he's like still so active and doing so many different crazy projects. Every single one of his projects is like weird and cool.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't doubt that at all.
Like, that's the cool thing this week is like it's for Hermes, and it's always for fashion brands. Right. And like, we did this one show here in New York last year where it was like basically, it was instead of doing a fashion, it was for this Kenzo H&M collab. Instead of doing a fashion show, we put together this crazy performance. It was like literally like over 100 performers, dancers. Ryan Heffington choreographed it, the same guy that choreographed the Kenzo ad.
Yeah, and which had amazing choreography.
Yeah, he's so awesome. And but yeah, we had like all these dancers, orchestra, the Dap Kings horn section, Kenny Muhammad, beatboxer, like I was doing scratching. Like a whole band, you know, and then all these dancers and this crazy stage set up.
Wow.
And it was like instead of a fashion show, we just did a performance. And it's always something weird and unusual with Sean Paul. And I do something like every month with him pretty much. This week it was like he had me mash up a waltz, the Merry Widow waltz, trap. Well, he doesn't know what trap is, though, but he's like, I want you to do your thing to like a waltz. But then I want you to, like, add birds to it.
Okay.
So it's like, oh, actually, like, everything is built off the last project. Whatever the last project was, it was, like, the last project was something we did for the Pompidou Museum.
Wow.
And that was where he came up with it. He's like, yeah, I want to do a waltz, but, like, super banging, like, your style.
Yeah.
And then this time it's like, okay, we're going to take that same idea, but now there's going to be birds. Because in this Hermes show, I guess there's these, this like, a lot of times he builds these automated like animatronic kind of creatures, and I guess there's animatronic birds flying around this cage.
Cool.
So he had me like, he was like, I want the birds to just be making noise, but then they get real rhythmic. So I like trapped out the birds.
Oh, so
the birds are like part of the
music. Are these field recordings, or did you they are.
Yeah.
Nice. Wow. Yeah, that's dope. I mean, that's a whole other world of like creativity there, you know, that to be able to do stuff like that is pretty awesome.
It's really fun, man. And his vision is always so weird and cool.
Yeah, I would think, yes.
And it's never like in the box. And then also, like, I feel like fashion stuff now is, I mean, I feel like fashion people are doing really dope shit. Like, it's so open. It's such an open format. Like, whether it's their ads or their shows, it's like, you know, I do a lot of stuff with Kenzo and opening ceremony too, and even through Jean Paul, and it's always like, wow! Every project comes through, and I never really know what it's going to be, but it's almost always something really unique and interesting, and I like changing it up. I like trying new stuff, you know.
Yeah, I dig it, man. I like it. I wanted to ask you one last thing before we kind of wrap up. Well, there's a few things that we didn't cover, but there's always something that struck me from back in the day when it's an appearance you made in a movie, and in Lost in Translation. So you're in the, like, near the end of the movie. It's like this very American moment almost where you're just like at that table in the bar where the friends are congregating and stuff, and you're talking about like making beats, basically, I think, or you're describing like a beat that you're making or some shit like that. Which I always thought, even from the moment when I saw it in the theater when it first came out, I was like, that's so dope that they got a dude that's just like talking about beats and shit. Was that just totally improvised, or like, was it a scripted thing? Like, what was that moment like doing that?
No, yeah, that was just improv.
Yeah.
I just had like, you know, I was like playing the DJ dude, so I was like, actually, I kind of like, I copied some, like, I took the voice of, I used to hang out with this dude, DJ Swamp, a lot.
Did you? Yes, of course. Yeah. Cleveland.
From Cleveland.
Yeah, exactly. Man. Dude, DJ Swamp, he's a legend.
Yeah.
That's what's up.
So I like kind of embodied DJ Swamp for a little bit during that scene.
Wow. That's tight. Yeah, because it's like you're kind of playing a character, too. even though it's like just a couple lines, like if you're, I guess, ahead, or if you know like DJs and dudes, especially from that period of time, it's like, oh shit. And at that time, I, with my old record label, I'd been going to Japan a lot during that period of time, so I licensed some records out there. So the kind of like American producer DJ guys that you run into in Japan, you know, it's like a, you have to kind of get to a certain place to just even get out there and be invited out there and shit. So it's always a trip to like run into like American artists in Japan. So it's like frames it in this certain way that I thought was pretty hilarious. So I always wanted to ask you about that. So you were, were you there for that, a lot of that whole film, or were you just
there for a week? Yeah, that's actually the first time I ever went there.
Nice.
But now it's like my favorite place. I was just there like a week before last.
Yeah, so that's amazing. So when you go there, can you do perform and stuff too? Or
Yeah. It was just, we did a show with Kenzo a week before last out there. And,
very cool.
Yeah, I performed out there quite a bit. We played with NASA, played Summer Sonic, and toured everywhere, like even at, like, Sendai and other cities.
Very cool.
That's like my favorite place.
Yeah,
to
me too, man. Well, I dig it, man. I love what you're doing. Like, I'm glad that you could be down to do this with me, take a couple minutes to do it. So, good looking out.
Man.
Thanks so much, man.
Fun,
appreciate
man.
It.
Thanks
yeah.
for having me.
Yeah, for sure.
That was awesome.
Yes, yes. Hey, thank you so much for listening, everybody. And thanks to our very special guest, Sam Spiegel, for taking the time. Go to squeakyclean.com. To see peep game, see where this guy has come from. You know, it went from just production and beats. Now it's like a full-on production company. Very interesting stuff that he's doing. He just produced and directed, rather, these two shorts for National Geographic, The Instrument and The Mirror, two different ones. Check those out. Before we get into this, I'm going to play a little bit of this single, Mutant Brain, with Assassin. Try and find that Kenzo short music visual that I was talking about. It's dope. Amazing. And the next record's coming out on Interscope as Sam Spiegel. To Whom It May Concern is the name of the track. CeeLo, Theophilus London, Alex Ebert. Peep that. And I'm so glad I finally got to figure out and hear, talk about rather, his brief appearance in Lost in Translation, one of my favorites. And thank you guys so much again. Please subscribe, however you might do it. Come back and check this out. This is a DIY thing. There's not a big I'm not part of a network, so support independent podcasts, you know what I'm saying? There's a lot of them, and I know that you have 50 million ones to choose from if you do indulge in podcasts. So any time spent checking out The House List with me, your host, Peter Agostin, is genuinely appreciated. It's a word-of-mouth thing, so feel free to copy and paste that link on SoundCloud, The House List Podcast. That's the title on SoundCloud.com. And, let's help get the word out a little bit here. And know that I appreciate it. And support Sam Spiegel's music and his production. The guy puts a lot of work into it, and he has for a long time. Shout out to Fat Lip from the Far Side, Spike Jones, and I also want to send a shout out real quick to Max Perlick, who I met up with in LA, kind of BC Boys lineage, and we recorded a bunch, and hopefully we're going to do some more, and then I'll have an episode with him eventually down the line. So yes, again, let's just keep this going. The next episode is episode 50, y'all, and then by September, I'm going to do a very special, another kind of conceptual rollout. So August, all doing two episodes a week, each week in August. And then September, I'm going to try something else, a similar kind of cool thing for the podcast, The House List. Thank you again, and I will see you next time. Peace, y'all. And as we let this joint roll out, I want to send a shout out to Blade, helping us coordinate this joint. Thank you so much, and to all the people out there. See ya. Peace, y'all. We have a first time.
who da wa do them bad. Trouble on a bad and a frazzle them. They must see you say that we dating off them ogle them. They must say that we have the girl them body and knuckle them. I do them. What we do? The novel them. Cause in a the club and we a pop up all the back. Them a say them can't run in cause we defend and we tackle them. And the water come out and we not see them. Back up on them a chat now we no care what them a say. Coming like them out and move but we no hear what them a say. We no matter what the hate and them a say your money.
Your body been.
Them a say. Yeah, yeah, me.